My name is Teresa Wellborn, and I'm one of the pastors here at University UMC. And indeed, in the name of Christ, we welcome each and every one of you on this joyful Pentecost Sunday. Here at University UMC, we believe that whoever you are and wherever you happen to be on your faith journey or your life journey, you are welcome here. You are beloved. Just a few housekeeping things as we get started this morning. First and foremost, want to share a big, warm welcome to our friends and family at Congregational Church of Austin. University of Austin, welcome. And to our combined choir and musicians, we're so excited about it. Service over here in our courtyard, our pastor and family and children, Pastor Heather Green, has worked to make sure we have snow cones. And so we hope that you would continue our celebrative morning over in the courtyard with some snow cones and some visiting with one another. Again, those housekeeping moments, if you have time, find the black registration pad in your pew so that we can have a record of your attendance this day. And just a couple of notes around that. Later, we will pass the plates. That's one of the things we pastors make sure that we do every worship service, right? We're going to pass the offering plates. But for our friends over at Congregational Church of Austin, either on the envelope or on the check, clearly write your church's name. And we have combined ushers even joining in this worship service. And so we'll make sure that as the money is counted after the worship service, it all goes to the right place. So it's all good. It's a joyful thing to worship together. And this day, I'm going to invite my friend and colleague, Reverend Amelia Fulbright, forward as she shares in our call to worship.
Let us join together now in inviting the Spirit to become manifest among us. In the beginning, please stand as you are able. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Darkness was over the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters.
Centuries before Jesus walked among us, the Spirit of God was promised to him, so that he would bring justice to the nations.
Jesus sent the Spirit of truth to teach us and give us peace.
At Pentecost, the Spirit came as a rush of violent wind and tongues of fire. That same Spirit is among us now. Let us worship God.
One, two, three.
Happy birthday, God!
We hope you have a great day celebrating. Thank you. What did you do yesterday?
Pool party.
Pool party is so fun. Well, today is another day that we celebrate. Do you know what we're celebrating? It's not the start of summer. Does anybody know what we celebrate today? Would you say it again? Oh, yeah? What else? What do you think? The birth of the church. Is that what you're going to say? That was what you're going to say. Yes, that's right. We're celebrating the birth of the church. So, and there's a story in the Bible that we'll hear in a little bit of all of the early followers of Jesus that are gathered and wondering, how are we going to share this good news with everybody? How are we going to let everybody know that God loves them so much? What are we going to do? And you know what happens? Something comes to them called the Holy Spirit. Have you heard that word in church before? The Holy Spirit. Yeah. Some of us, yes, some of us. You know, people for years have tried to figure out how to describe the Holy Spirit. In the Bible, they use an image of fire. You see that? Some of you might have had a chance to color this in Sunday school today. You see that? You did? Some of you might have made a hat to celebrate it. So I'm going to think about fire for a second. What does fire do for us? You can make s'mores.
Yes.
What does fire do for us? It gives us warmth. That's what you were going to say? What were you going to say something, Jack? No? That's right. It helps us cook things like s'mores or meat. What were you going to say? And it gives us light. So I wonder today if we can think about the Holy Spirit in those same ways. It can provide us nourishment, right? Food? Did you have something in?
And it can burn.
And it can burn, that's right.
It can burn people.
So we also have to be careful, right? It can give us light, so the Holy Spirit can help us kind of see things in a new way. And it can give us warmth. So I wonder if the Holy Spirit can comfort us and make us feel good. Can we think about that? Because you know what? Pastors for years have had a hard time describing the Holy Spirit. So we're going to try to think about it in those ways today. Does that sound good? Does anybody want to take one of these to color in your seat or back in the chat care room? You're welcome to do that. You already did one. You know what? I did too. Here we go. Celebrating the Holy Spirit. All right? Will y'all say a prayer with me? All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for today.
Thank you for
the Holy Spirit.
Thank you for the Holy Spirit.
May she provide us
with warmth.
Our prayer for illumination can be found in the red hymn.
Thank you.
there were devout Jews from every people under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Syria, of Lebanon, of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds and power." All were amazed and perplexing one another. "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Walter. We'll get kind of situated here. We're a little sparkly with the microphone, so we'll hopefully not blow your ears out. So we're getting all situated. And you know, I think one of the smart things that we pastors do, especially on Pentecost, is have a layperson read the Acts passage with all those big names. So good job, Walter. It's good to be here together and see all in your faces. So I just wanted to share a quick word about who I am. My name is Teresa. I've been the pastor here for just under 2 years, so that's about how long I've been here. And I'm married. My husband, Paul, usually sings in the choir. He's back there, and we have a 13-year-old daughter together. And I'm Cradle United Methodist, and now I'm United Methodist pastor. So Amelia, why don't you share with us a quick word about yourself?
Yes.
There we go. I am Amelia Fulbright. I have been the transitional pastor of the Congregational Church of Austin for also a little under 2 years. Some people say that all pastoral ministry these days is transitional ministry. So I just happen to wear that title proudly. I am married. My spouse, Jonathan, works in IT, and he's somewhere around here wrangling our two kids, Vivian, who's 8, and George, who is 4. And I'll just take this opportunity to say a heartfelt thank you to you all for having us with you today. What a blessing and a gift to do this on Pentecost.
I think it's fitting for churches to come together on Pentecost for such a time as this, and it's been a joy to get to know Pastor Amelia. I look forward to more conversations together and more sharing as our churches come together. One of the things about Pentecost is that it really is all about relationships, God being with us and us being together. And as Pastor Amelia and I were getting together and I was thinking about this Sunday, I was thinking about how first of all, Amelia, usually on Sunday mornings, this place is packed. Like in the balcony, like it's full. Like this is like not really typical.
Sounds familiar.
And, okay, I'll stop being silly and sarcastic. In all seriousness, we are going to get to some good stuff. We talked about some good stuff and some hopeful stuff. But we also talked about just being real and holding space and naming that this is a challenging season in which to be church. Maybe even just to be alive, right? But this is a hard season. Have you found that to be true?
Yes. Yes. You know, the scale of change that we are witnessing and living through is just kind of mind-blowing. You know, just in our congregation, like all congregations, we have lived through a pandemic. In 2020, Congregational Church of Austin's longtime pastor retired. Their longtime music minister retired. We've had a lot of death and loss in the last year. Many beloved church members have passed on or moved out of state. When we come out the church doors, we look around West Campus and we are surrounded by student high-rise apartments. We look south towards the state legislature and can't look that way too long or you lose all sense of hope. No offense to the people that work down in the Capitol. Much gratitude to the people who labor there day in and day out. You know, we look at the effects of climate and the storms we've lived through, literal and figurative, in the last few years. And even if you are a person who seeks adventure and newness, it is just hard to hold space for that level of change, those layers of change, the pace of that change, and not completely lose your orientation.
Thank you. That normalizes maybe some of our experience here. One of the things I think about that's the gift of Pentecost is that we have this Holy Spirit that comes, and certainly the Holy Spirit, I at least hope that many of us experience God's presence with us in the form of the Holy Spirit providing us comfort in the midst of disruptive times. It's always been interesting in theology classes that the Holy Spirit is the one member of the Trinity that is often assigned kind of the more maternal or feminine nature. We even heard Pastor Heather kind of pray Holy Spirit using the pronoun she. And again, I hope that some of us have experienced the Holy Spirit as that comforting, maternal type presence in our lives, kind of like a warm blanket or mama bringing you warm chocolate chip cookies and milk when you're feeling sad. And I think about that, but this is not the Holy Spirit that shows up on Pentecost Sunday, right? This is the Holy Spirit, more like my mother, who would come down the hallway hollering, "Now have you finally cleaned your room up?" This feels like the disruptive, calling us into action, calling us to be the fullest sense of who we are called to be, turning the world upside down. This is the Holy Spirit feminine power that is at work on Pentecost. And that can be unsettling, especially at a time that already feels unsettling. That's one of the things I think about. So I think we have these paradoxes of like, we're receiving peace, but then the Spirit comes to shake us up and to disrupt us. And one of the things we're often told, Amelia, we know this, right, that the Pentecost moment is the birthday of the church. We're celebrating the birthday. And all fun and that sort of thing. And I was thinking this morning about my own significant birthday coming up this summer. Megan said 25, she's just a little off. And people are different. Some people love celebrating their birthdays. I've never been a huge birthday celebrator, and the older I get, the more I'm like, eh, I don't need people to remind me how old I am. And then I thought this morning, University United Methodist Church this year is 136 years old, and y'all don't, we don't look a day older than that. 136 years old. So parties, it's the both and. They can be celebrative and fun. But for some of us, there's also some grief and sadness because we know that we don't look like we used to look. We live right next to the University of Texas campus, and similar to the changes your church is going through, we see the high rises, and this place isn't as packed as it used to be decades ago. And so it's hard to live with that when we think of, like, what does this next birthday look like? And I came across a quote from Kathleen Norris that I shared with Amelia that I wanted to share with you all this morning. And Kathleen Norris is a Christian writer, and she said this. She said, disconnecting from change doesn't recapture the past. Sometimes we wish it did. Disconnecting from change loses the future. And the Pentecost moment for us today, I think, is to wonder and to be curious about what new day God is calling us into. The Church of Christ is not moving backwards, it's moving forward into the future, as troublesome as that future seems at times. And so there's a place, it's appropriate to hold grief for what once was, and to miss that and be sad about that. That's the peace that the Holy Spirit will come and comfort us in those moments. But I also believe that we are being called in this Acts passage to have visions and to dream. One of the things that I think about when I think about dreaming dreams for the future of the church is that I will confess, Amelia, my dreams are often lukewarm. I want to keep them kind of realistic, lower my expectations so that I won't be disappointed. But God is calling us, I think, in this Pentecost moment to dream boldly on behalf of the world. I wonder if y'all been having any dreams over at Congregational Church of Austin.
We have, and we've been trying not to keep it lukewarm. Things have been heating up over at Congregational Church of Austin. Really, for 7 or 8 years now, the congregation has been imagining possibilities for the redevelopment of our property. As you know, those of us who sit on this land near the university have a great asset that is sought after by many people. And the church has been dreaming about what that might look like for years now. And just last Sunday, took a significant vote where we had looked at some different options, including maybe sale of our property and moving to a different part of town. But our church voted overwhelmingly to stay in our current location and begin the process of working with a broker to redevelop our property. And it's not going to be just a renovation or a facelift. It is going to be a whole reconfiguration of our facilities that may mean the taking down of our current sanctuary, our current safe space. And we'll be salvaging what we can, like the beautiful stained glass and the wood and the symbols that us who we are and the values that we hold, but 2 or 3 or 5 years from now, that space is going to look entirely new and different, and it is a source of both deep grief and joyous excitement. try to mourn the losses that will come, but also stay open to the dreams and visions that are possible that we can only barely catch a glimpse of. I think that's our challenge in the days ahead, is to not be limited by what our finite minds can imagine, but to know that God, through the power of the Spirit, can do, as the scripture says, immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine.
Thank you. I can already hear the gasping from some of the people at University UNC. I just want to be clear, I did not invite Pastor Amelia here today to say, and now we're going to do the same thing. Unless the Spirit shows us otherwise down the road. But in all seriousness, our prayers are with you, and we'll be looking forward to hearing and seeing how that process unfolds. And for here at University UMC, we certainly have been continuing to have conversation about what it means to rethink the ways that we are church today. And so I look forward to what might be here at University UMC as well. What you're sharing reminds me of something I heard once that this question: What is God calling you to do that you cannot do without the help of something beyond yourself? Again, so many times we want to rely on ourselves, but God is calling us to do and dream these dreams where it's like we're going to have to rely on the Holy Spirit, because this is so big, we can't possibly do it on our own. And what a gift the gift of relationship is, to know that we are not alone, that thanks be to God we have the gift of one another, that we have the gift of God's Spirit and peace with us as we move through these times. I look forward, and I hope that this is just the beginning of our churches continuing to partner and seeing what that looks like in the future. Thank you, Pastor Amelia.
Thank you.
I know that Pastor Amelia brought one of my favorite writers, John Donahue, has a blessing for the gift of fire. So I'm going to step aside from the pulpit and so that you can read and close our time together with the pulpit. Thank you.
Hear these words of blessing. Let us praise the grace and risk of fire. In the beginning, the word was red, and the sound was thunder. And the wound in the unseen spilled forth the red weather of in the name of the fire, the flame, and the light. Praise the pure presence of fire that burns from within without thought of time. The hunger of fire has no need for the reliquary of the future. It adores the eros of now. When the memory of the earth in flames that lick and drink the air is made to release its long enduring forms in a power of ashes left for the wind to decipher. As air intensifies the hunger of fire, may the thought of death breathe new urgency into our love of life. As fire cleanses dross, may the flame of passion burn away what is false. As short as the time from spark to flame, so brief may the distance be between heart and being. May we discover beneath our fear embers of anger to kindle justice. May courage cause our lives to flame in the name of the fire and the flame and the light. Amen.
Thank you. We believe in your divine breath, the giver of life that brought forth all creation from the face of the deep as everything began. Let us take a deep breath of your spirit and join your work of creation. We believe in your breath of justice that inspired the prophets to proclaim your word and challenge the world. Let us take a deep breath of your spirit and carry out your mission of purifying the toxic socio-political air of our time. We believe in your breath of love that the resurrected Jesus breathed on the disciples, saying, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Let us take a deep breath of your spirit and create more breathing room for those who need love and care. We believe in your breath of communion that enabled the community to emerge on the day of Pentecost over all the racial, cultural, and language differences. Let us take a deep breath of your spirit and be your holy church in this world, striving to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Let us see the visions and dreams of the new world always.
Thank you.
As it is announced at the beginning of the worship service, the members of the congregational church may indicate your church name on either the envelope or on the checks. We don't mind your offerings, but there is an option. Now, ushers may come forward.
Thank you.
we know that invitation from Christ this day is to take this birthday party to the streets, to continue to be church together for God in this world. Just as the liturgy, you may have noticed, carried elements from both the Congregational Church of Austin and University UNC, the prayer of dedication used here in this building, the doxology, the words used at the Congregational Church, a wonderful way for us to celebrate our diversity coming together. And so I hope that you will take time to linger in the courtyard. If it's over a snow cone or you just want to chat with somebody, please know that that's available for you. Let us unite our voices in our closing song, Oh, for a Thousand Times to Sing. It's in our hymnals number 57. It might sound a little different to some of our ears, though, as the choir leads us. Each of these has prayers from both of us. of our congregation. So we're going to keep one here, knowing that it has some of our prayers as well as some of your prayers. And we want the Congregational Church of Austin to take one of these. And you will carry some of our prayers as well.
Thank you so much.
May we continue to be together. We're going to share together this benediction and then go forth in peace. This comes from a good UCC, yeah, by Aaron Terabasi, who shares this Pentecost blessing. May your tongue tingle with the good news.
May your heart open to all the people on the street.
And when you are bent over in sorrow, may you find the Spirit's feather on the ground,
waiting there to give you hope.
Go in peace. Amen.